Excellent. So the webinar recording has now begun. So as I said at the start, welcome. Thank you for joining us today to our event, Transitioning from Uni to Work, How to Start Well and Stay Well. My name is Anna Buttonshaw and I work at the Local Government Association on the National Graduate Development Program for Local Government, which thankfully we refer to as the NGDP. And I'm joined today by some current trainees on the program, current and recent trainees, Risha, Ed, Georgia and Tom. So we'll come to give a little introduction to them in a minute. So as I say, where we're going this morning, we'll do some quick introductions. And then I'm going to speak a little bit on what it's like. Apologies, you can hear that. That's a fire engine going past. The realities of working from home. We've got, we'll talk a bit about what it's like to enter the working world as a graduate trainee. I'll give a little overview and then our guests will be having a bit of a discussion along that line. We'll talk about what it's like to become an employee, some of your expectations, rights, and responsibilities. And then we'll talk about personal well-being. And on each of these topics, I'll give a little overview and then we'll have a bit of a discussion. If you've got any questions, for myself or for our panelists, then please do make use of the chat. We might take them as we go along, and of course, we'll leave time for questions at the end. So I've got you all in named order. Risha, do you want to kick us off and say a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Risha. Like it says on the screen, I'm at the Royal Borough of Kensington and Chelsea, which is an inner London borough, and so like really unique in terms of what the residents. There's a lot of really affluent residents and a lot of residents that live in pockets of poverty. So it's different every day for sure. My current placement is in the growth and delivery team within planning, which is completely like new to me and something I never thought I'd do, but really enjoying it.
Fab, thanks, Risha. Ed, do you want to give us a little intro to you?
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Good morning, everyone. Yeah, my name's Ed. Again, like it says on the side, Ed Groom. I'm based at Cambridgeshire County Council, which is a large county council. We're in the centre of the country. I've actually recently come off the scheme. So I was a member of Cohort 21. I did a variety of placements. I worked in climate change and energy. I did a 6-month placement in our transformation service, and I also worked for 9 months in education, and I recently have been successful in obtaining a permanent role at the council as a manager in the chief executive's office. Thank you.
Fab, thank you. Ed, Georgia?
Hi everyone, I'm Georgia. I'm based in Sutton, which is in outer South London. And I'm just about to move on to my next placement, which is in organisational development and working on gender and racial equality in the council. So I'm excited for that.
Fab, it does sound really interesting. Thanks, Georgia. And Tom, last but not least.
Yeah, save the best to last. Morning, everyone. My name's Tom. Again, as it says on the slide, flying the flag for the Northern Councils today. It is a whole spread about the England scheme. So if you're ever involved in Northern Councils or got any questions, let me know. So I'm currently working in homelessness prevention at Sheffield City Council. My previous placement was in housing as well. So if that's something you're looking to go into, then feel free to fire across any questions.
Fab, thanks, Tom. I know it's always such a topic of interest and rightfully so. On to our first agenda item. Being a graduate trainee. Now, some of you joining us, I recognize, might be current university students. Some of you might already be out in the working world. This is one of those strange things about doing a virtual workshop in that we don't get a chance to chat with you at the start or the end of the event in person. But whatever your experience of the working world and study, being a graduate trainee is a really unique opportunity. And I just wanted to draw out a few factors that are quite different about starting work as a graduate trainee as compared to a sort of normal job that you might have held in the past or perhaps other opportunities that you're considering. So being an a graduate trainee, then you've usually got a central contact point for your graduate scheme. Now, that might be someone on a large organizational level. You might also have someone on a placement or lower down organization level. But this can be something that sits outside of your usual line management. Now, that's a term we'll come into a bit more later for those who aren't familiar. If you have concerns about adjusting to working life, receiving support, or just uncertainty about what that transition will be like, this is a huge benefit of being a graduate trainee from my perspective, that you've got those central contact points in place, people who you can go to from day one with any concerns or for any support, and who can also help to manage and promote your own development during your time on the graduate scheme. You've possibly, as I've said, got a separate point for your employment, your line manager, and our graduate trainees can talk about, some of them have quite a few different contact points. Sometimes that can be a little confusing, but the hope is that you've got lots of levels of support and input for you as you're adjusting to the world of work. Something else that's very different about being a graduate trainee is that the vast majority of schemes, including ours, provide the chance to rotate between three or four, is the typical number, different roles during your time on the graduate scheme. For us, you stay within the council that you are employed by, so you're not changing location or employer every 6 months, as I know some graduate schemes do. You're in one place, and what you're doing by rotating different placements is you're getting a huge wealth of experience, a range of contacts, and a really wide view of the organization, which to us is really critical in being able to push you faster up into a management position when you finish the scheme. So it's a key facet of many graduate programs for that reason. You, on our scheme and many others, will have extra responsibilities around learning and development. Those are really fantastic opportunities in terms of your personal and professional growth, but they definitely do come as an added pressure on top of working life. I'm sure our trainees can speak to that. And then another benefit is the network of peers. So those joining our call, our panel today, may not have had the chance or many chances to meet in person, but nevertheless, they remain a network of people who are sharing similar experiences with similar values and drive to make a difference. And that network of peers, I know over the years, trainees have found incredibly helpful. And so those are my sort of top thoughts about being a graduate trainee. But enough from me. Let's hear from our panel. So for those of you on the panel who worked before, perhaps in a part-time role or perhaps in a full-time role, what was different for you about starting the NGDP, starting work as a graduate trainee? Any of you are welcome to kick us off. Just hop off mute.
I'm happy to go first.
Yeah.
I guess for me, the more part-time roles before the NGDP were sort of student jobs, maybe in supermarkets or work at the university, and then moving to Sheffield Council, I think I had a bit of an imposter syndrome, maybe somewhere it was unfamiliar territory, a more structured line of work, like you previously mentioned, and a line manager and things. But I guess one of the things I learned quite quickly is that most people who are your seniors have been in your position at some point in their careers. So even though you have that sort of sense of imposter syndrome, maybe in the first few weeks, you soon get to realize that everyone is there to support you and that they've all been through the process that you're going through before. So they do understand quite a lot of maybe the thoughts and feelings that you're having. So honestly, I'd say just be honest with how you're feeling and people are there to support you.
That's fab. Anyone else who found that feeling of imposter syndrome rising as they took on the label of graduate trainee from our panel?
Yeah, definitely I did. And I think part of that is because the work is supposed to be challenging because it's supposed to be developing you into a leader. So there's always that element of being stretched and being slightly hopefully uncomfortable. Like that's supposed to be a good thing if it's at the right level. But I think because there's that stretch as well, there's a lot of support, like Tom was saying. And I found that quite different from other jobs.
Fab, thanks. Any other thoughts on this one from our panel?
I don't know if do you want me to go, Risha, or do you want to go?
Go ahead.
Oh, thank you. I was just going to say, just to build upon the support point. I think our most counts, which sort of kind of participated in the scheme for quite a long period of time, I know Cambridgeshire has, and kind of therefore they're very well versed in kind of supporting and developing graduates. And I found that, I mean, the counts obviously, because they're paying for your wages and for your qualification, for your training, they're very invested in your development. And the managers will give you time and their energy to kind of to push you on. And I feel like from my perspective, that is kind of the main difference that I've found between jobs I've had before and being on the scheme. I think there is a real vested interest in pushing you on, which is obviously what you want.
I think, definitely echoing everything that's been said before. I think the main thing for me actually that was different to previous jobs was like the longevity of it. Then my previous jobs, I kind of felt like when I left, that was fine because someone would just take over doing, the shop role or whatever. There was no real like impact of like me personally being there. But I think with this job and being a graduate trainee, like the others have said, they put so much into you specifically that there's a reason they chose you for your role at the council. So it does genuinely feel like you're making a real impact, like both within the council and like the jobs that you're doing.
Yeah, that's fab. Really interesting to hear so many differences really in taking on that role. What aspects, and you've touched on this a little bit in talking about support, several of you, but what aspects of a graduate program would you say are most important to look out for when some of the students or graduates who are on this webinar might be considering several options? I'm sure while we obviously believe really strongly in the NTDP, we're not naive, and we know the graduate marketplace and the public sector marketplace are very full, and often people are considering several options. What would you say are the top things to look out for when you're choosing a graduate job? Anyone can kick us off.
I can kick off this one. I think, at least for me, variety was really important. I think the beauty of doing a grad scheme is that it's almost a little bit of an extension of university, where you're not in a permanent role and you're having to do one thing. This is almost like the last chance you'll properly get to like move, bounce around teams and be completely brand new to something. So I think that's important. And I think as well, it's a bit cliche, but like what grads on the program say about it, if you can reach out to people on LinkedIn or like just, word of mouth or whatever, if people seem to have a positive experience on their grad scheme, then it doesn't matter. I think at least like the pay, the opportunity, where it's located, like you want to feel valued and supported while you're on the journey of it.
Yeah, those are some great points. Ed, Tom or Georgia, anything to add?
Yeah, I was just going to say, I think as well, it's I know it's hard because it might be your first job out of university or first graduate scheme, but think about your values and what you want out of a job. Again, you can only really speak from personal experience. So for me, I did quite a lot of work with homelessness charities in Sheffield University before I joined the scheme. So I knew that was a passion of mine. So I was sort of looking for jobs and careers in grad schemes around the area. So if you have a certain passion within local government or even within your local community that you want to make a difference in, maybe just do a bit of research around different councils and if they even have sort of a bigger interest in that sector. I think just go on personality experience on what you want to get out of work and things that you value.
Fab. Yeah. Anything to add?
I was going to say, I think a lot of the points I was going to have been touched upon, like the values, the experiences people have had. I think the long-term prospects are always good to think about as well. What people do after the scheme, I think, was something that I personally was quite interested in. I wanted to see kind of what it was leading on to. I mean, I still don't really know exactly what I want to do long-term, but I think it was interesting to kind of look at what or people that have been on to do the NGDP before me have gone on to do. And again, just highlight highlight the variety of those roles that people have gone into. I noticed like the broad spectrum of opportunities and the broad amount of doors that are opened by embarking on this scheme.
Yeah, that's fab. And it's really interesting. You know, Tom, you said I came with a really defined interest and wanted to look for opportunities to do that. And Ed's still saying, actually, show me more. I'm not certain yet. And both, there's room for both of those within our graduate scheme. And it's just, as you've all said, worth thinking about whether a graduate scheme is pushing you in one very refined direction, where you're having to, from the outset, define a specific part of your career you'd like to focus on, or whether it is a generalist scheme is more appealing to you. But there can be room for both specialty and broad appeal within a generalist scheme as well. Georgia, anything to add?
I was just gonna add that I think for me, it was really important to have a lot of development as part of the scheme and for that to be specific. So I guess it's easy for organisations to say that they're really focused on your development without you really knowing what that means, but also the support to help you do that well. And I think we'll come on to more of the wellbeing stuff later, but that balance was really important to me, and I've definitely found that to be the case on the NGDP.
Fab, thank you. So coming on to being an employee. Now, those of you who are listening in today who might already be in work or who have more experience of work, some of these terms might look really familiar and maybe a little bit boring. But when we were considering today's workshop, we just wanted to reflect on actually how intimidating some of the employment language can be when you're first adjusting to work, or if you've had a role where you've been predominantly studying. So there are things and ways of being things like line management, which is within your role, the person you're responsible to for your work. And perhaps some of our trainees might be able to speak to what it's like to be a line manager as well and function within that sort of organizational structure and the responsibilities that that involves. Things like one-to-ones where you're meeting with your manager or other colleagues to do, give updates, review practices. Many jobs will have an annual review, but there might be quarterly reviews or monthly reviews of your progress as well. Organizational policies. Most organizations that you look at will have a whole enormous section of their website around organizational policies. And I don't know if any of our panelists would join me in, you know, remembering when you first click on your organization, sort of human resource policies or IT policies or training policies, this enormous list comes up and can feel really overwhelming. There's a lot of information and structure out there, but it's not always immediately accessible in the way that you'd like it to be. So it's always something we can talk about. There's things like organizational culture, which can be a really tricky thing to pick up on. What kind of clothes do people wear? How do people relate to each other? How formal are people? How informal? A lot of that is influenced by the sector in which you're functioning, but every organization is very different. And it can, again, be a really intimidating thing to face the prospect of adjusting to a new way of being and want to sort of fit in, but still be yourself, and how to balance that. There's really practical things like, do your employer use a specific set of documents or structures? What's the email tone like? What's the etiquette? How do people sign off their messages? Then we get into practices that for me really begin to touch on well-being, and we might come into this more around things like home working and staff networks, human resources, annual leave and flexible working. So all of these sort of terms and jargon really come into a question for our panel, which is, out of all of these sort of structures and phrases and practices, what did you guys find the biggest adjustment to be when you were starting work? And I suppose connected to that, is there anything that you would do differently or that you would recommend as people are facing the prospect of kind of adjusting to these ways of being an employee? So Ed, you're top of my screen. I don't know if you want to go first.
I was gonna say this is a very interesting question. I think especially coming from university, I think having to book your leave and plan your time off in advance is very important. So when you're at university, obviously you're used to having your reading weeks off, you have Christmas, Easter, obviously you have a large break over the summer, whereas in the workplace you only for Cambridge, I think I have 25 days a year. And obviously it's important to plan that well in advance, therefore your team can plan around your workload and all that sort of thing. Steph, I think for me that was the biggest thing. Obviously I wouldn't be able to have as much time off or as much time to rest as I used to, and obviously planning ahead in that case is really important. So I think for me that was the most difficult one, but I like to think after a couple of years, I like to think I'm used to it now anyway.
Yeah, it is a huge adjustment, and I think you forget that sometimes. Like me, I've been working for sort of 10 years or more, and it does seem a long time ago having those summer holidays, but it can be a huge adjustment. Yeah. Tom, you're next on my screen. I don't know, did you find the adjustment to annual leave really tricky, or was it something else for you?
Yeah, I guess I touched on this in my first answer about imposter syndrome, but just another thing is it's small things that you've already mentioned, like email etiquette, and like I've never really, apart from university, written formal emails before to maybe managers or line managers. But I think, again, repeat myself, but you've got to remember that everyone starts at your point. And even those little things that you think are stupid questions that you might not want to pop up to your manager and be like, hi, stupid question, but how do I do an email signature, or how do I respond to X, Y, Z? Don't be afraid to ask those questions, because the sooner you ask those questions, the sooner you get into the flow of working, and all this organisational jargon and structures and stuff soon becomes the new normal.
Yeah, fab. Georgie, you're next on my screen.
Yeah, similarly to Tom, I found getting used to emailing people really tricky, particularly senior people. Like, I didn't really know how to contact them, and we use Google at my council, so you can send people a hangout, which is a message, so you can get like a quicker response from people. But it took me a long time to feel confident enough using them with people that I didn't know so well. So yeah, I probably would have started just doing that sooner, because you're not being rude by trying to get in contact with someone. It's for the good of your work. So yeah, I just think I was a bit scared about that.
Yeah, that kind of, it's a combination, isn't it, of what is the common practice in communicating in the council, and also maybe a little bit of that imposter syndrome, like I am important enough to speak to important people, isn't it? Risha, how about you?
I think in all honesty, a lot of the things that were on that slide are an adjustment. Some of them will be bigger for other people, for some people, and smaller for others. Like for example, for me with my email signature, I go with kind regards, because all the others just sound really cringe to me. Don't know why, they just do. So that's why I've gone with kind regards at the end of all of them. But like in terms of workplace culture, I think returning to the office, like post full-time working from home, has been really interesting, because it's almost trying to navigate like how to be a person at the same time as being an employee in the office. Like, how much do people chat to each other? How much do people talk about their lives? How often can you get up to get a coffee, or run down to the canteen, or like leave the building to go to Starbucks, which I do. So it's things like that I think have been quite an adjustment. And I think what's helpful, and it's helpful throughout like starting a job, whether you're working from home or being in person, is just observing what other people do. And like I think Tom said, not being afraid to ask. No, there'll always be someone there that's thinking the same thing as you, someone that's from a very similar background, someone similar age, someone who started their job 5 minutes ago but might be 20 minutes old, like 20 years older than you. So yeah, there's always someone that you can ask, and more than likely someone else thinking the exact same thing that you are.
Yeah, I think that's such a good point. It can be very easy to feel like you're the new person, I had a colleague who kept introducing himself as the new person, even months into the role. And, you know, I think it showed a like, oh, just it was like a little warning flag of I'm still feeling new. And it's OK to feel that way. But don't ever stop it from helping you to reach out and ask the just the really practical and sometimes really important questions when it's who do I speak to in HR about this practice, or I've got a concern about something that's happening, or I feel like I can't do this piece of work because I don't know what structure to put it in. So what is your top tip? We may have covered this, but for adjusting to the expectations and structures of a new workplace, either in preparation or in the first few months. I know that many of you have been saying, you know, don't afraid to ask the silly questions, which has been a really common theme. Any other tips for those who are listening in? Anything to do in advance that comes to mind?
I've got one. It'd be flexibility. The NGDP, most councils have placements. So in Sheffield, we have 3 placements or 8 months. So we move between teams or sectors. And flexibility, because one placement could be you in a team with 25 other people, you've got a line manager, a very organisational structure, and then the next team could be equally as important, a different policy, but a smaller team. So you might find you're now working with maybe you and just one other person on a particular thing, a bit more specific. So maybe don't go into different schemes with perceptions and pre-expectations. I'd say try and react to the environment that you're placed into. And be flexible to different organisations, because although they're in the same council, all teams do work differently and they work differently with each other. Flexibility would be the word that springs to mind for me.
Yeah, that's great. I see you nodding, Ed. Do you have anything to add to that one?
It's a bit like the asking questions one, but before you start at your council, I know before we start and then for like subsequent graduate cohorts, we always kind of put the new grads in a WhatsApp group with the current grads, and before they even start at the council, obviously then they it's possible for them to ask questions of us, like the basic ones like where's the best place to live, kind of does it take long to get in to the office, kind of what are the nearest restaurants, cafes, what places to get lunch, all that sort of thing. I think it is possible. I mean, I don't actually know if other councils do that or if it's just us, but I think it's just good to kind of perhaps to open those barriers of communication before you even start a placement, like Tom said, or before you even start at the council. It's just good to ask those questions. Or perhaps you're scared to ask, because then obviously when you start, means you're as best prepared as you can be.
Yeah, fab. Risha, any thoughts from you on this one?
Yeah, kind of just going off what Ed said there, and mine's going to be like find your support system as early as you can, I think. And that for me, that's been my fellow grads. There's 7 of us in my cohort. There were 6 the year above, and now there are 5 in the year below. So I think it's really nice to have those connections that you can speak to and have people in the exact same boat as you. And in terms of the structures of a new workplace, I would just write things down, like in the same way I did at university. I would just make myself like a little folder of notes of like the directors who sat under them and who sat under them in relation to my piece of work, so that when I saw a name in an email or a meeting, I could immediately be like, oh, I know who that person is, and I know why they're interested in this piece of work. So I think just like keeping track of things in whatever way works best for yourself can be really useful as well.
Yeah, definitely. I remember in my first job, there were a lot of acronyms, and I just had a page in my notebook with all the acronyms and what they actually meant. So you could kind of like hop over and look a little less confused, you know, maybe at least about 50% of the time. Georgia, any thoughts for you to round us up on this one?
Just thinking about the structures of a new workplace. I think I find it really helpful just to kind of use being a graduate as my in, and just to organise chats with random people to find out what their role is like. And that's helped me to kind of understand how different teams in my department work together and how they work with other parts of the council, And then if I need to ask someone a question later down the line, I've already said hi to them. And I just find it helps me to build some kind of connections and friendly faces. So I found that really helpful.
Yeah, great tip. Now, on to what I think of as actually the really the highlight of this webinar, which is personal well-being. And, you know, when we're talking through some of these really enormous changes to working life and the transition from university, there's so much that comes with that. And there've been little hints of it along the way. But for many graduates, they'll be facing relocation. So either moving away from where you've been living during study, or moving away from home, or where you've been living temporarily and adjusting to a new place, kind of as you were saying, Ed, you know, where's the best place to live? Where do you eat? You know, how do I get to the office? Is there like a back route? Or, you know, all of those questions, moving somewhere new is a huge life shift. There's the aspect of new routine. And I think, was it Tom or Ed, you spoke about this in terms of booking annual leave, getting used to that practice of building in your own rest breaks, but also defining what your working day looks like, what your non-working time looks like, and establishing that that adjustment to a sort of 9 to 5, 10 to 6 pattern can be really different to sporadic lectures, maybe a part-time job on the side. All of those aspects can be really tricky to adjust to. I've just written lifestyle change, and it's maybe not that simple, but yeah, that shift from being a student, if that's what you currently are, to being an employee in all of those sort of structures that we looked at a few slides ago can involve a huge amount of lifestyle change. Your relationships can change, the introduction of new responsibilities, maybe again, relocation coming into this, meeting new people, getting used to having colleagues and how do you relate to them? And of course, just your health in every way. This can be a real time of change, and often we'll have cases of, you know, physical health issues or mental health or other aspects that start to change or adapt in response to the new pressures in both positive and negative ways. But it's really important, I think, to look at all of that because that's a huge part of your life. And I know for us in local government and on the scheme, we're not expecting you to deliver objectives as a robot. We're really looking to foster a culture of personal well-being, which is enabling you as an individual to deliver on your goals and the goals of an organization. So enough from me on that. From our panel, how would you recommend staying well, and in any sense of that phrase that's been pertinent to you, during that period of adjustment to work? So any tips or personal experiences that you want to share about just how you either did stay well, or looking back, things you wish you'd done differently when you were in that adjustment period to working life?
I would say, so I'm an introvert, and I would say that maybe particularly for introverts, adjusting to work and adjusting to a new like place is such a massive transition. So definitely be patient with yourself as you're going through that. But some things I found helpful to transitioning to a new like place and neighborhood, local Facebook groups are really helpful. I've joined like a choir and other community groups just to meet people. And I think so, some of those things are only stuff that I've done recently since we've come out of lockdown, and I wish I had the opportunity to do them earlier on. So I definitely say make the most of those opportunities as soon as you can, but also try to have reasonable expectations of yourself. And if you are an introvert especially, don't do too much, don't commit to too much, don't beat yourself up if you have to cancel some plans because you're just a bit socially exhausted. So just take it slow and be patient.
Yeah, that's really important. Tom, I see you've come off mute. Do you want to go next?
Yeah, I came off mute because Georgia just triggered something in my head. I guess the sense of moving to a new place and starting a new job, there's so much pressure for you to walk into a perfect job, and it's never really the case. Like, it's okay to not really get along with something maybe you walk into in the first place. I'm currently in my second placement and I'm enjoying it a lot more than my first placement. I think maybe I walked into that placement in the council, my first placement, thinking it's going to be perfect, it's going to be the best thing in the world. I've got my graduate job, but it's okay to not get along with everything that you're doing. You'll learn a lot about yourself while you're adjusting, learn a lot about how you work and how you work with other people. And maybe something you thought you would be good at or something you'd like in your job, you might join and maybe not get along with it so well. So I think it's about giving yourself that time to adjust and that time to settle into your council and not putting so much pressure on yourself for everything to be perfect, because not everything's perfect in life. And just give yourself time to adjust and don't put pressure on yourself, I think is what I'm trying to get at.
Yeah, does that resonate with you, Ed and Risha?
Yeah, completely. Oh, sorry, Risha. I'll let you go first if you want.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, definitely. I think my primary recommendation would be to like set boundaries for yourself from the beginning within the role. So like I've not moved away from home since starting. So my biggest adjustment has been like the job. And I think like putting in time for lunch, saying you're not going to finish any later than, you know, five something that you do from the beginning is really important, not just for your well-being, which is what is the most important for, but also for like standing your ground as an equal employee with other people. I think in a grad, and I've heard people say they feel like as they're the most junior position, they just have to yes everything or take on all the work that the team isn't doing, and that's not the case. You are an equal, you do have a life. You should be learning, growing, and having enough time to really enjoy the work while you're doing it. So taking that hour out for lunch, finishing, you know, 5:30 or whatever it is really, really important. I'm just so sorry, Ed. I just saw a question in the chat about COVID and just about like work-life balance. So I think that's why that was so important to me from the beginning, because I think being your authentic self at work is so, so important, but that shouldn't mean taking your work home into your personal life. You're not like a 24/7 public servant. You're a 9-to-5 public servant with a 24/7 interest in helping people and value of, you know, supporting vulnerable people.
Yeah, fab. Thank you, Risha. And I'm just looking through the chat now, which I left for a couple of minutes and has been very busy. I'm just seeing if there's anything that we've missed which is relevant to this bit right now. I think a couple things will come on to at the end, but it's definitely been a really strange time for all of you to be adjusting to a graduate role within the remit of COVID. And I think that some of those lessons about drawing boundaries and with your work are really, really healthy. And especially as people are looking at almost like adjusting to the new normal or the next phase, or goodness knows what's coming our way, then it's almost something you have to come back to with each shift, isn't it? In that time. Just wanted to touch on this question for a minute. What is the conversation like in your council around mental health and employee well-being? And perhaps as an add-on to that, are there any things that exist or modes of support that you've kind of discovered as you've been there, which you wish you'd engaged with from the start, or which you did engage with from the start and have been a really helpful support? So I'm not sure who'd like to kick us off on that one.
I'm happy to go first if everyone doesn't mind. At Cambridgeshire, recently over the last year, they've started to do these monthly wellbeing hours, and they're always on a different topic. So for example, one was about stress relief, and they talk through kind of different things you can do if you're worried about particular work or home based issues. One whole hour on like home exercise. They've done ones on kind of mental health awareness and suicide or prevention, and our managers have also kind of put more focus on that in our one-to-ones as well. So the first question I always get from my manager is always about my well-being now, and it's the same when I do one-to-ones with people that I manage now, is always about their mental well-being as well. Ever since working at home as well, I've noticed teams and kind of people put in more time just to have like half hour catch ups with you, because obviously it's much harder to catch up with people now that we're not in the office as much. So one thing I've noticed is people put more time in the diary with you just for catch ups. Yeah, so our team do weekly catch up now, and as grads do weekly catch ups as well. So yeah, like the current grads, former grads. Obviously, I think there's been more focus on it at Cambridgeshire, especially. Well, in my obviously personal experience, since COVID.
Thanks, Ed. Anyone else on this one? I wondered, have any of you engaged with any staff networks? Because this is something that I think in the last few years in particular, councils have been really growing and investing in a lot of staff networks, or the people who work there have been doing that. I'm not sure if any of you have engaged with staff networks at all.
Yeah, I've engaged with a few, and I would also say there is networks on the NGDP itself. So I'm involved in the Northern Network of NGP, and there's plenty of networks to be involved with. And as well as organising events that are surrounded by that topic or you're interested in, they always do work. They also work very well as well-being sessions. As Anna's mentioned, most of our work is online, so it's a good time to sort of chat with other graduates and get to know people better. And you can sort of share experiences and also share fears. And you also realise that a lot of people from different councils are experiencing the same thing as you.
Yeah, fab. Anyone else on that one?
I've been involved in some staff networks at Sutton. I've been involved with the youth network, which is more of sort of an early careers network, which is really helpful for kind of helping us get used to the workplace and help each other out. As well as the women's network, and they've done events with the BAME network to focus on the experiences of women of colour and kind of having learning sessions, and it's just a really good way to learn about other people's experiences but also find that solidarity in whatever stage of life or whatever you're in.
Yeah, I think definitely echoing what's been said about like staff networks. I'm involved with the Black, Asian and Minority Ethnic networks for the council and both the grant scheme. And like I said, like I think I mentioned earlier, it's about like support systems, I think, for me. In terms of what the council are doing, I will say that I think anyone that works in the council will say like it's not perfect. There's always going to be room to grow and learn for organisations, leaders and people. But what's, I think, really good about working in a council is that they are fairly adaptable. Like, we have surveys that go out annually and they do try to respond to those concerns and see what can be done to provide more support. For example, there's been like a round of mental health first aid training that hasn't been around for a while in the past year or so, and things like that. So there are opportunities out there to improve it and to like change what you, like change the gaps you see in your organisation.
Yeah, fab. That's such a good point. And I think for me, just one final thought on this, I would say that for any of you considering applying to the graduate scheme, if there are outstanding issues in your own well-being, then please don't sit and think you need to hide those away in a cupboard. Please don't see them as a disadvantage. They're part of who you are. And we're really keen to support everyone to perform their best in the assessment process and to support them when they're on the scheme. So we really encourage people, if there's something outstanding, and there could be so many things, we're all really different with varied challenges and life experiences and sort of physical realities, then please don't feel like you need to hide part of yourself away. We're really keen on supporting everyone. And so if that's you and you have a concern about it, please drop a line to ngdp.support@local.gov.uk, especially if you're concerned about an impact that something in your life will have on the assessment process. We're doing a workshop tomorrow on reasonable adjustments, which you're welcome to join us for or watch back after. But my big point here is, you know, do reach out no matter what stage you're in. People are there to support. And as Risha said, not everyone's going to get it right the first time. But I think there is a real sense, especially in local government, of being on a journey to together to support people and to learn and to do that so that everyone can be there, be at their best, if that's not sort of the most horrific cheesy phrase. Seeing our next slide just brings us to questions, really. I think we had a couple of questions around placements, location and employment after the scheme. Ed, it was you who's moved into a permanent role, am I right? Would you mind just talking us through your experience of transitioning from sort of the graduate scheme and finding a permanent role and what that was like for you?
Yeah, absolutely, happy to. Yeah, so I started to look for jobs about 5 or 6 months prior to finishing the scheme, because obviously I was getting a bit kind of antsy about it. I was a bit concerned that I wouldn't find anything, but Cambridgeshire were really helpful, and perhaps I should put out that graduates, Cambridgeshire have got a really high retention rate. Yeah, so we always tend to keep the graduates when they finish the scheme. Obviously people do eventually tend to leave, but yeah, not straight after the scheme. And I've not met your grads that have failed to find a job. So I think that's a really important point to make. There are quite a few jobs came up that I applied for at Cambridgeshire. The job that I'm in now is actually advertised as a secondment, where I work in the chief executive's office, which I applied for, and I was interviewed by our chief executive and leader. I had to present, and then was asked a lot of interview questions. I didn't actually think it went that well, but obviously it must have gone better than I thought. And I was successful, which obviously was really positive. I found the council really supportive, because they've obviously spent with time and money helping your development. So obviously I had my qualification paid for it, and they paid for other things for me to do as well. So I attended quite a few other courses while I've been at the council. So things like project management, I did my prints too, and all that kind of thing the council paid for. And obviously all the mentoring that I got from different managers around the council. So I didn't find it to be as difficult an experience as I was expecting. I would say that a job's obviously not guaranteed, but I think the council obviously have got a vested interest in keeping you, seeing as they've put you through all that training and all that mentoring. So I wouldn't kind of be concerned about it. If people are perhaps worrying about it, I'd say don't. I mean, obviously there's all your placements to go through first. So I actually found it to be quite a rewarding experience. I mean, I obviously hadn't done any recruitments since I got my place on the scheme. So it's quite nice to be able to dust off my CV and to be able to reflect upon all the things I'd done on the scheme. So actually it was quite a nice exercise as well to be able to go to the people that were interviewing me and be able to talk about all the things that I'd done. So I actually found it to be quite a nice experience in the end. Obviously it's a bit daunting, the interview itself, but it went well in the end.
Yeah, fab. And we've got a couple minutes left if anyone's got any other questions for myself or the panel. I know lots been going on in the chat. I'll just speak to a couple of points while we leave a minute for that, around questions that have come up. So there've been some questions in the chat around placements and how does that rotation work. And I think if you scan through the chat, you'll see some of our panelists have given an example. Each council does function in their own way, but I would say the vast majority of councils will work on on a couple of major premises. They'll be looking for really important and interesting projects in the council which align with business needs. They'll be looking for placements where there's a really good track record of line management, because as many people have said, you know, they recognize you're in a very most people are coming to this in an early career space. So if you've got other work experience, that's fantastic, but we're not expecting that of you. And so usually placements are looking to build in that line management and mentoring support. And then especially as you start getting into the graduate scheme, the vast majority of councils are really keen to help you pursue either areas where you want to look because you don't know very much about it and you want to learn, or areas where you're beginning to define a real interest or a specialty in a skill set or a topic, then most of the councils that I know are really keen again to give you those experiences which are relevant in building you up in your career. And as Ed and others have said, you know, there's a real desire to help you advance in your career, and particularly at that council, but also generally within the public sector, as they've made such an investment in you over your time on the scheme. So there is some variety, but there's pretty much a consistency, and there's almost always a place for you to have your voice in expressing your interests and your needs when it comes to a placement. I thought I'd touch briefly on location. So as you can see from our panelists, we work with between 50 and 60, sometimes upwards of that, local councils in England and Wales every year. And what we do is at the end of our assessment process, then all of the candidates are given a full list of the councils who are taking part, and they can give us their priorities of where they would like to work on a council by council basis, but also indicating their regional interests. And what we do is undergo a really vast and complex matchmaking process to give you job interviews with some of your top prioritized councils, and taking into account anything that might be in the way, like caring responsibilities or a mortgage or a need to be somewhere specific. And then a successful job offer does pend a successful interview. So that is how location works on the scheme as well. I'm having a really quick look. My colleague Elise has put a link to our webpage where the application process is indicated. So very much encourage you to take a look at that and some of the support structures that are in place there. I will say that we try to provide opportunities to practice for each stage of the assessment process. So on our website, you'll find resources to practice for our situational judgment test, which I very strongly encourage you to look at. And we'll be providing resources around video interviews, which is the next stage, and also assessment center, which comes after that. If you look on our website, you'll also find our key skills and behaviors. And these 8 criteria are the criteria that every stage of our assessment process is measuring. So it's no mystery what we're looking for. If you study and ponder on those key skills and behaviors, then that's really one of the best places to start when you're looking at the assessment process. Now, I think we haven't had any new questions come to the fore. I've got one hand up, I think, in our meeting. So, Anata, would you like to come off mute and ask a question?
Yeah, thank you very much, Anna, for the opportunity. I would like to ask a question. I know that this might be unrelated with the topic of the meeting, but I would like to ask in terms of the application of the graduate, NGGP graduate scheme, because if I'm not mistaken, when I apply, I need to conduct the online test. So considering that the application is closed in January, should I kind of take it more time to kind of practice first before I apply, because after that I need to done the online test, or I should kind of like apply as soon as possible and maybe done online test as soon as possible to avoid the role being closed? Thank you very much.
Thank you. And that's a great question about the assessment process. Yeah, we're open for a really long time, and that is so that people have a lot of time to hear about the program, to practice and to apply when the time is right for them. So if you're working or studying, there might be really different points in the calendar year in the sort of 3 months that our applications are open that are going to be the best time for you to study for and do our situational judgment test. So there's no advantage to completing it early or later. It's really just about finding a time where you can prepare and do the test without pressure. It's an untimed test. And so when you can start your application at any point, you should be able to save it and leave it. And then when you're ready to do the situational judgment test, then you can start that test, complete it, and then your application will be formally submitted. But there is no advantage to doing that now versus on the last day, as long as you've given yourself enough time to do it in a non-pressured environment, I would say. We review all marks when everyone has finished the tests, and we compare that against our equality and diversity data to make sure that we're not seeing any adverse impact from the test. So that's why there's not an automatic sort of pass or fail when you complete. We do a lot of analysis work to make sure that it's completely fair and equal before we set those boundaries. And so that's one of the reasons there. So I think that brings us to the end of our questions. If there is anything lingering for anyone, then I've linked to our website here. You can follow us on Twitter. We do have a group on LinkedIn, and this email address I've listed is the best one if you've got a question about how to apply or anything that perhaps we have covered here today. So let me close with a huge thank you to our panelists for giving their time and being open about their own experiences. So thank you so much. Just in my screen order, Ed, Georgia, oh, I've gone too far, Risha and Tom, a huge thank you from me, and I'm sure from our those who are watching, for your time today. Do take care and do get in touch if you have any questions. Thanks very much.